Everything they were about was about prayer. When Jesus told them to wait in Jerusalem for the Holy Spirit to come down, what did they do? They prayed. They sat down in the upper room and they prayed. And what happened? The Holy Spirit came down. How did he come down? He came down in power. If you read Acts chapter 2, it says this. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly the sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called Pentecost Has Arrived, Acts chapter 1, verse 1 to 11, by Steve Williams.
What's special about today? Joan, you had your hand up. You can sit down, by the way. It's Pentecost. Who can tell me what Pentecost is all about? Anita.
It's about when the Holy Spirit came down on people and they started speaking in tongues in Acts.
Okay, it is the time when the Holy Spirit came down in a new way where everyone who believes in Jesus will receive the Holy Spirit. Is that exciting?
Yes.
That is exciting stuff. And that's what we're celebrating today. In fact, today at the North Oak Clock Tower, we are going to be celebrating Pentecost there. That's the whole reason why we're there, to acknowledge that Jesus is alive, and he's alive also through the Holy Spirit. Excellent stuff. But before we carry on, when we was doing the worship, when we was worshiping God, this song that spoke to me, and it asked me one question. Are these words relevant to me? We're singing these words out. We're worshipping God. We're saying all these things to God. And it says this: Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. You are everything. Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. Be my everything. And when we sing these songs, is that what Christ is to you? Is he your everything? Is he in everything you're doing? Because that's what Christ asks of you, is that in everything you're doing, he is the center, he is the foundation of your life and everything which you're about. Is that what you want in your life? Is that what you want in your life? Because you're singing these things. You're singing these things out to him. You're worshiping him and saying these things to him. And worship is a prayer to God, saying, I want this in my life. Do you honestly want him to be your everything? Is that a yes? Is that a no?
Yes.
So one of you, it's a yes. Good, I'm happy you came. But for you, I hope that he is your everything. Because if he is your everything, you'll be something in this world for God. Amen. If you turn to your Bibles and turn to Acts chapter 1, it's page 1092 in the church Bibles, this purple one here. And it's chapter 1, verses 1 to verses 11. In my former book, Theophilus, I've wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit." So when they met together, they asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." As he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? The same Jesus who you have seen taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." And the story goes on, and later on they spend time in an upper room, continually praying together. Last week, and we looked at the incredible thing God is doing amongst us in Greenford Baptist Church in terms of many people coming to faith. We've seen 19 people baptized in the last 5 or 6 months. And we're looking at the whole area of momentum, of how we can be aids to God in terms of keeping this momentum going, what God is doing amongst us. We looked at the whole area of how it's important for us to pray and repent from our lives and live a clean life, putting God first. And we looked at how by doing that, we will see our nation healed. We also looked at the parable of the tenants, being faithful with what God has given to us as this church has been one of those things, and the people God has entrusted us to reach each day of this week. So we need to be continually looking at how we can be an impact in the community around us. And today, we look at an area which, to me, is the heart of who we are. Because with the Holy Spirit within us, we can make a difference. We can do things which are unthinkable, because God's Spirit is within us. Without him, we are nothing. With him, we have something within us which can change the world around us. So, on our own, we can talk about God, but there's no impact. With the Holy Spirit, we can talk about God, and God can turn situations around. Now, to me, prayer and the Holy Spirit are a two-way thing, really. Because as we pray and see God do things in prayer, his Spirit intervenes and changes things around us. And I'm involved with a business. And the business I'm involved with hasn't been doing brilliantly up to about January this year. It's making a loss. So Wendy and I prayed about this business. We said, "Father, do something about this. We believe you gave this to us. Turn things around here. Do something which is new. Bring some business into this company, because we want to use this business for you." Up to that month, we was taking in probably a 10 grand loss every month, which is a lot of money. But it's not a lot of money if you worship the living God, because the living God can turn things around and change situations around us. We prayed about this in January. We told the workforce we are praying about what is going on in this workplace, because God can turn things around. I spoke to the accountant. God is going to turn things around here. Do not worry. The Bible says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition, present your request to God, and his peace will fill your hearts." That month, we hit a record turnaround in orders. In February, we hit a record turnaround in orders. In March, we hit a record turnaround in orders. People are blown away. What's going on? Well, we prayed. We prayed about it. And God's Spirit has intervened. But we had another problem. You see, all this stuff's come in, all this work's come in, but it takes X amount of months, if you're a business person, for the cash to come in, because you've got to make the product, then the cash is going to come in. I mean, it was sort of hundreds of pounds from the end of our overdraft. So basically, we were running out of money because money hadn't come in. So we prayed about it again. We said, Father, you've given us this company, do something about it. Turn things around. That day, got a phone call from a company saying, we want to do business with you. We'll pay you up front today with the money you need for you to do your business for us. Which is unheard of. Unheard of. They pay us up front quite a substantial bit of money, and it's given us a real sort of turnaround in our cash flow situation. And that's what I mean by when we talk to God in prayer, he can intervene, turn things around, whatever situation there is, and make a difference. What God is teaching me here is that this is the big thing, this business. You've got to lift it up in prayer regularly. Not just now and again, not just today, not just yesterday, but it's a continual thing. But in fact, that is just an illustration of your life, Steve, because everything which you're about, you're going to lift up into prayer to God. Everything. And then the Holy Spirit will intervene and change and put situations into place where they should be. There's a partnership between prayer and the Holy Spirit. I've gone off on a tangent here, but never mind. Because this is what it's all about. It's about you and God. It's about you and your relationship with God. And you know, I was reading a book, and in this book it said, look, you can talk to people about God as much as you want to. About him. You can say, I know this God is great, you can do this, that and the other, you can change your life around. But if you don't talk to God about these people in the first place, how do you expect him to intervene? It's very well talking to people about God, but if you're not talking to God about the people you're trying to talk to, what do you expect to happen? We need to be a people who are putting prayer up there in terms of allowing the Holy Spirit to touch people's lives around us. If we're not doing that, we'll be doing things on our own strength, and we will not see the potential of what God wants to do in the church around us. We want to see God continually to bless us and touch our community. We need to be a praying church. And it's like this. I've got, he's got broadband here. You've got broadband, Joan?
I haven't.
No, not your broadband. You've got, broadband internet.
I'm not.
No, you're not. You're not. Your dial-up. Sorry. Oh, your dial-up. Your dial-up. He's got broadband. Put your hand up. Okay, right. I got broadband some years ago, thinking, gosh, this is fast, isn't it? It's fast. When you get broadband, don't you see how fast it is? Okay. And then I got this letter through saying, if you want even faster broadband, go to Sky and get it at 16 meg per second. Thinking, I have some of that. It was free of charge. It's part of the package I got. So I've got this Sky, I've got the router, plugged it all in. There was no difference. No difference at all. And I rang up and said, look, it's not any faster than it was before. It was fast, but it wasn't as fast as it's meant to be. So I complained, there's nothing wrong with anything of your equipment, everything is fine, it's all okay. About 2 months ago, we had a problem with our telephone line. And rang up BT. They said we tested your line. Everything seems okay from your point of view. From your point of view, I think it's on our side. So they came in. They said what it is. See that thin wire going across your house to that telephone pole? It's damaged. So they changed it. They changed that thin wire. And communication was how it should be. First of all, I could speak to people on the phone. Before, I was just getting this little crackling noise. Hello, 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 nothing at all. Nothing at all, couldn't hear anything. The line was fixed. But the amazing thing is, my broadband now is working at super fast speed. It wasn't before. It's like, oh, I'm there. I'm in that website. You wouldn't know this, Joan, you've got dial-up. But and everything was going through so quickly. Everything was working how it should be. And the reason why I'm using this illustration is quite simply this. When we live the life we do casually as a Christian, when we don't have prayer and allowing the Holy Spirit to work in us as he wants to, we will see God work amongst us. We will see things happen. But you won't see things happen as he would like it to happen. Because when we connect to him in an effective way, in an effective prayer way, where our life is centered on prayer, we will see God's activity in a much more supernatural way, happening day in, day out. It won't be just the occasional times when you see God is working amongst you. It'd be an experience which would be natural in your daily life. If you want that, it means a commitment in terms of how we talk to God. When we look at this story in Acts, the incredible thing about this story is that prayer was, I mean, if you look further down in this story, prayer is very much the heart of the early apostles' lifestyles. Everything they were about was about prayer. In fact, virtually every chapter within Acts has some reference in where they spent time praying together. They had a situation in Acts where they were had a problem with feeding people, so they had to ensure there was people waiting on tables so that the apostles and other people could spend time in quality praying together. When people were in prison, they prayed that they would be released. They were released. Then when they were released, what they did, they thanked God. Everything they were about was about prayer. When Jesus told them to wait in Jerusalem for the Holy Spirit to come down, what did they do? They prayed. They sat down in the upper room and they prayed. And what happened? The Holy Spirit came down. How did he come down? He came down in power. If you read Acts chapter 2, it says this. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly the sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now, when you look at references in the Bible about the Holy Spirit is illustrated as wind. Soft wind, strong wind, powerful wind. He's illustrated as fire. He's illustrated as water. Sometimes he's illustrated in a soft, gentle way, but other ways in a very powerful, demanding way. This is what we have at our disposal. Well, actually, it's the opposite way around. We're at his disposal for us to be used by him. And all the things you see in the New Testament of miraculous things happening, that can happen in your life. That can happen tomorrow. That could happen this week. That could happen today. That could happen throughout your life. But you've got to want it. You've got to want it. And it does start off with us and prayer. You see, the Holy Spirit equips us to be who we are in God. And there's many things he does for us. And some of the things he does for us are these things. In Luke, it talks about him teaching us. In John, it talks about him testifying about Jesus. In John, it talks about him convicting us of sin and showing us where we are in terms of us and God. In Romans, it talks about the intimacy we can have with God as the Holy Spirit seals us as his children. In Galatians, it talks about the fruits of the Spirit and how he molds us into characteristics of Jesus. In Corinthians, it talks about the power of God, how he empowers us with gifts that we can do miracles in our lifetime, in our workplaces, wherever we are, in this church, wherever we are. There is so much we receive because of the power of the Holy Spirit. But the most significant thing to me is this. If you turn to Ezekiel, it says this. Ezekiel chapter 11, 19-21. It's page 838. Ezekiel chapter 11, 19-21. 838 in the church Bible. It says this. I will give them an undivided heart and put a new spirit in them. I will remove from them their heart of stone and give them a heart of flesh. Then they will follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. They will be my people and I will be their God. You see, one of the differences between what we believe in Jesus and what other faiths talk about is that God comes into our lives, comes into our hearts through his Holy Spirit and transforms us. He is part of us. He is connected with us. He is intimate with us. That's who we are. This body is a temple, is a vessel which holds part of God within us. If we allow him to, if we ask him in. And you know, some of you may have asked Jesus into your lives but not being baptized, but I honestly believe, if you read Acts 2:38, it says this: Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. If we truly are serious about putting God first in our lives, about allowing God to be the centre of who we are, you know, I believe that when we ask Jesus into our lives, he comes into our lives. But if something significant happens to you when one is baptised, it is an illustration of an old life going under the water and a new life coming up. But also, it's something spiritual happens to us in terms of us and the Holy Spirit. God's Spirit fills us in a powerful way. So baptism is something you need to consider, if you haven't been baptized, to be touched by the Holy Spirit in an effective way. Because the package of coming to Christ means, yes, asking God into your life. Yes, recognizing Jesus died for you on that cross. Yes, recognizing that you can have a life fulfilled by having him in your life. But also it means turning around from the things you're doing in your life and living it for God. And you can only do that by the power of the Holy Spirit. You can't do that on your own. And the key to it to me is this, is that if we want to live a life for God on an empty field of gas, we can casually be a Christian as we are. But if we want to truly be servants and soldiers of the living God, where we are effective, powerful women of children of God. We need to allow him to come in more and more and more. In Ephesians, it says this. It says that, be filled with the Holy Spirit. We as human beings are flawed. We can allow God to come in, but because of our lifestyles, we lose a bit of what God wants to do within our lives. We need to ask him for more and more and more of his Spirit within our lives. And in doing that, we'll be transformed into his likeness. By doing that, we will see differences in the life we live. And people will see differences in the life you're living as well. Church, do you want this? Do you want this? If you want to see this momentum continue, if you want to see what God is doing continue, it's up to us to take this on seriously in terms of our prayer lives. It's easier to pray when you're in this environment here. But when you're at home on your own, and you've got children running up and down, and you've got the ironing to do, or whatever you're doing, these things are there as a distraction, you think. But no, you can pray to God anytime. You can pray to God anywhere. You can pray to God at any place. You don't have to go to a sanctuary to come to God, because you are a temple. You are that temple which God has called you to be. Wherever you are, the temple of God is going wherever you are, because that's who you are. You are a vessel of the Holy Spirit. Last week, it was on Friday, we went to Ivan's funeral. And I was speaking to Teresa, and Teresa was saying to me that it is really great that Ivan became a Christian. And he's the only one in his family who had a relationship with God. 3 years ago, there was no one in his family who had a relationship with God. But one of the things Teresa said, it'd be great if there could be a key into that family which could make a difference into that family. I believe that key was already Teresa, because Teresa already started something there. But this morning, we had two people come to church today from that funeral. Teresa and I spent time with them during the reception time. And they came today. But these are people who are very influential in that family. And I believe as we talk to God in prayer, God will give you opportunities through his Spirit to be influential in people's lives, for them to be influential in other people's lives as well. But by talking to God together and going to that funeral reception, in a time of trauma and difficulty, Jesus was there. Jesus was amongst them. And Jesus will continue to be amongst them as we pray for that family. As we pray, the Holy Spirit will intervene. He'll raise people up. He'll bring people into their lifestyles and to change things around them. But it's up to us to be a vessel of God wherever we are. Some of you here go to work, go to places you go to each day, and you're thinking, what is my purpose here? What am I doing here? Why am I here in the first place? Why can't life be different? Why can't life have a change? And you know what? The change is required from your attitude with you and God. Because when your attitude with you and God changes, you realise the purpose why you're there is not for you, it's for God. is for God. The reason why you're in that home at this moment in time is because of God. The reason why you're in that workplace is because of God. The reason why you're in that school or your children are part of that school is because of God. God has placed you there for one reason. You've got a mouth, you've got legs, you've got arms. You're there to be his body. You're there to be his mouthpiece. You need to ask God one simple thing, or many simple things. Who do you want me to relate to today, tomorrow, the rest of this week, the rest of this year, in this place you put me in? Because your spirit wants to work here, and you place me here. And as we pray and have an attitude like that, our work focus changes. Our home focus changes. Is it a neighbour I need to speak to? Is it Mary over there? I don't know what their names are at work, whatever their name. Is it who I need to speak to? Is it that person there? When I was in, when I went to Portugal with the family last year, when we go on holiday, what I like to do is ask God during this holiday. Is there anyone you want me to speak to during this holiday? And there'd be a hotel full of probably, you know, hundreds of people. And I feel God say to me, right, that person there, these are the people you need to speak to during this holiday. And during that holiday, a conversation or something will happen where I'm able to express something about my faith with those people. Now, they may not become Christians, but that's not the important thing. The important thing is that God's Spirit is at work with those people. Other people will be raised up with those people in God's timing. In your workplaces, in your schools, it's the same thing. Who does God want you to interact with? Who does he want you to be praying for? Who does he want you to be touching? Who does he want you to see healed in your workplace, with your neighbours? Because you are the body of Christ. You are that person who is unique in that workplace. You may be the only person who knows God, who knows Jesus, in that particular part of the world you're in. If you don't tell them about it, who else is going to? And as we interact with God, as we interact with him, there's no reason we can't see powerful things happening amongst us. People have seen prayers answered. People have been healed. I was at this workplace this week. And this guy said to me, I've got a bad back. I've had it for 20 odd years now. Ever since, I used to do a lot of extreme sports. Like he does sort of a lot of windsurfing and mountain climbing and all that type of stuff, and his back's gone. So I said to him, well, I'll tell you what, can I pray for your back? He goes, what can I pray for your back? And I just left it like that. So I prayed for his back. I don't know what's happened, but what matters is that the option's there. It's not, I don't do anything. Jesus does all the healing. He chooses to heal. He chooses not to heal. But if we don't open our mouths in the first place and be bold about what God wants to do through us, we will not see these things happening. Who wants to see miracles happening amongst yourselves in your workplaces and in your homes and in your church? Who wants to see these things happen? Who wants to see God touching this community in a powerful way in which we'll see people touched by his Holy Spirit? I mean, when you read the stories in Acts and read the stories of revival, people say that even walking past the church, we were falling over because God's power was so magnificent. Wouldn't it be great if, oh look, someone's falling over there, it's the power of God. You know, wouldn't it be great to see that power amongst us. And you know what? It is amongst us. I was in Cyprus, and I was teaching in this Filipino church. I think I mentioned this story before. And there was such a hunger for the Holy Spirit in this church that when we had this appeal at the end, Adam and I were praying for these people. They were falling to the floor because this power of God was coming upon them. And they got up, queued up again to get prayed for again. And it went on for about, it was there for 2 hours praying for people. It was a congregation about this big, but every time we prayed for people, they kept on coming up wanting more. Are we hungry for God in a similar way? And we want more and more and more and more and more. Because if you are, you will see things happen amongst you. We will see people come to Christ. We will see people healed. We will see people transformed. We will see lives changed. And you know what? It starts off with you. It starts off with you. You see, if we come with an attitude of prayer, we will see things happen. And God's Spirit will be released into the places we're at. But it's like this. In the environment God has placed you in, ask Him to do things like this. Help me to treat people fairly. Help me to have a good reputation with people who don't know me, know you. Help me to be used so that others will see you in me. Pray that your lifestyle shows something of Jesus. That you have conversations which are wise and sensitive and enticing. Pray that you be bold and fearless wherever you are. Pray that you be alert when doors are opened. Pray that you be able to be clear to explain the gospel. Pray that you'll be able to expand and influence people around you in terms of Jesus. These are the things God wants to do through you. Be specific in what you're praying about, and God will touch the people around you. There's no reason why the gifts of the Spirit cannot be used in the workplace. In fact, if you look at the book of Acts, majority of the healings were out and about. What we have here is a safe environment to enjoy and encourage each other. What we're out there for is to bring that out there where people need to be saved, where people need to be healed, spiritually, physically. So pray for yourselves that God will use you. But also, pray for the people around you. Pray that the Father will draw Himself to those people. Ask Him what people you want me to share my faith with. You know, when we do Alpha, one of the things we do right at the beginning is that we have a group time and we say to them this one simple thing. Ask God during this time to reveal Himself to you. And you know what? Many of those people have an experience where God reveals themselves to them. Whether they make a commitment to that experience or not, that's between them and God. But ask God to reveal Himself to the people you are amongst. Pray pray also that Satan will not restrain what God wants to do through you to these people's lives. We live in a battle, and as you walk into these places, you're bringing God's kingdom into a place where his kingdom is going to be expanded. And he's not going to like that. Let's stand, shall we? I want you to think about your own lives. I want you to think of your life as a mission field which God has entrusted to you. I want you to think of the places where you walk and where you talk as part of that mission field where God has entrusted you. I want you to ask the question to God, what do you want me to do in these places where you are walking and talking for you, whether it's the workplace, whether it's the home, whether it's the neighbourhood, whether it's the church. Because that song we sang says, be my everything. And his everything isn't a Sunday morning thing. His everything is every part of your lives. The small things, the big things, every part of it. And he wants to release in you something new. He wants to give you a new attitude. He wants to give you a new mind. He wants to renew every part of you, that you can be that being he's called you to be. Let's pray, shall we? Holy Spirit, just fill this place now. Fill this place now, Holy Spirit. Touch this place now and anoint each person now. I pray, Father, for the different lifestyles which are represented here, the different areas in the community which are represented here, each person being in a different segment in this area we live in, Father. The neighbourhood, the workplaces, the schools. Each person here represents you. Each person here brings something of you in there. Touch your people, anoint your people, fill your people, Father, that they are equipped, that they are equipped, that they are equipped. Let's just be still in God's presence for a few moments, shall we?
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020-8575-5034, and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.